I'm really excited to be here today to do a very brief overview of planet migration in our solar system, what that might mean for life, and what it means in other solar systems. I'm going to focus on two main questions here because I don't have a ton of time. First, how do we actually know planet migration happened in our solar system? I think it's important to understand the context of that. And then what are some of the most exciting open questions about this process, both in our solar system, and these same open questions will apply to other solar systems, especially how that relates to the evolution and the spread of life. So first, how do we know this actually happened in our solar system? I'm going to talk about the evidence we have from the distribution of orbits in the outer solar system, some thoughts from general considerations of how planet formation proceeds, and then some evidence that we think this should be a pretty common process throughout the universe. So first, because I'm going to talk a little bit about orbit distributions, I have to define my terms. I'm going to show some plots that describe semi-major axis, eccentricity, and inclination. The semi-major axis is just the average distance from the sun that an object has. The eccentricity is how elongated that orbit is. So the yellow orbits in this plot are large eccentricity orbits. The circular red orbits have zero or low eccentricity. And then, of course, the inclination just describes their mutual tilts relative to our reference plane. So in this example, which is typical for Kuiper Belt, these nice circular orbits also have relatively low inclinations. The more eccentric orbits have larger inclinations. So with that in mind, the evidence from the distribution of these orbits in the outer solar system. So here I'm just going to plot all of the known or reported Kuiper Belt objects. So this population of objects that orbit out past Neptune in our solar system as of last month, and this is actually a zoomed in view. We have some more objects than are shown here. And this provides our best evidence of planet migration in our solar system. But I have to go back a bit to some context to say why these plots mean something in terms of planet migration. So we have this nice picture in our heads of how planets form. There we go. So we think of the planet formation as happening in a gas and dust disk early in the solar system. Planets form out of this nice organized disk, and so will the planetesimals that don't end up being in the large planets. And then you end up with this nice system where you have a bunch of planets and small bodies on circular coplanar orbits. And this isn't entirely just a fiction. We can now actually take images of planets as they're forming, and we do see what looks a lot like our concepts, where we have planets carving out gaps in these nice disks that are coplanar and circular. And in our Kuiper Belt, we do see some evidence of this leftover planetesimal disk on these nice, dynamically cold, low eccentricity, low inclination orbits. So in red here, I've highlighted what we kind of call the cold classical Kuiper Belt. So these are objects, Neptune's at 30 AU. These are objects that are between 40 and 45 AU. They have relatively low eccentricities, relatively low inclinations. There's some physical properties that they have that suggest they are distinct from the rest of the Kuiper Belt populations. They have different surface properties. They have different binary fractions. So we really think this is a remnant of that nice organized planetesimal disk. But then you'll note that there is a ton of really highly excited, dynamically excited orbits. We have large eccentricities, we have really large inclinations. I've actually cut off this plot at inclinations of 35 degrees, but they go up much higher than that. We even see some retrograde orbital inclinations. And this is really telling us that there were a lot of dynamical processes going on in the early solar system. And in fact, our best line of evidence, I think, is a large population of objects that are in mean motion resonances with Neptune. So you get a mean motion resonance when two objects' orbital periods around the sun can be simply related to each other such that they have a repeating geometry as they both orbit the sun. So this little animation is showing a 2-to-1 resonance where the inner object orbits twice for every single orbit of the outer object, and they always come back to conjunction at the same spot, and this creates a resonant effect. And in the solar system, in the outer solar system, we see a ton of Kuiper Belt objects in these mean motion resonances with Neptune. So I've just highlighted a selection from a single observational survey of the Kuiper Belt here, a survey that I was a part of. And we had some 200 to 300 objects found in resonances with Neptune out of a total sample of like 800 objects. So we see a huge pile up in like the 3-to-2 resonance with Neptune, which is what Pluto is in. But all of these other high order and even very distant resonances all the way out to the 9-to-1. And this is really indicative of some sort of capture process. If you were to just throw down objects in the outer solar system, some of them would end up in resonance with Neptune, but not as many as we see. So it really is strong evidence of capture via some dynamic process, and the most obvious one would be actual movement of Neptune. And this was really recognized early on as evidence of migration. So Renu Mahatra in the 90s made the point that if you thought about Pluto and its 3-2 resonance with Neptune, the best explanation for Pluto's both dynamically excited orbit and the fact that it's in resonance would be if Neptune moves. So you can imagine an early solar system here. We're going up in time as we go up the slide. So Neptune and Pluto have formed, they're just hanging out, but then planet migration starts, and Neptune starts moving outward. As Neptune moves outward, the locations of these commensurabilities, these mean motion resonances, also move outward. Eventually, the location will overlap with where Pluto happened to form. And you can actually capture bodies into these resonances. And then as Neptune continues to migrate, the object will get dragged along as Neptune's resonance moves out. It'll get dynamically excited during this process. And so this was recognized as one of the very early clues to the fact that Neptune migrated in our solar system. Now, we have a much different, more complex picture of this process now because we have a lot more Kuiper Belt objects than we did. But this general concept still holds and is the best explanation for why there are so many resonant objects. But there's also just if we think about the planet formation process in general, it makes sense that planets aren't necessarily going to stay put where they are when they form. And this was first suggested for our solar system for Uranus and Neptune in the 80s by Fernandez and Ip, saying that they probably should have moved around radially in the planetesimal disk out of which they formed. So this is just a movie I'm gonna show of a numerical simulation where you have three large planets. They're embedded in a massive planetesimal disk. So you got the three planets, a lot of small bodies that also have mass. And what happens when you actually let them self-consistently gravitationally interact is that everything kind of blows up and moves around. So this is just a natural consequence of the fact that if you have small body populations and they are massive enough, they're going to interact with the planets and cause the planets to spread out as they scatter these objects all around. So in fact, just the existence of the Kuiper Belt is a really strong clue that planet migration happened in our solar system. Because we have this debris disk in our outer solar system, it is just exterior to where our outermost large planet is. And that's not just a coincidence. Now, we also think that this should just be common, and there's some evidence for that because we see debris disks around other stars that are kind of Kuiper Belt or asteroid belt analogs. We see this through infrared excesses, so you can observe the star and say that there's this excess infrared emission that implies you have a small body population that has collisions and creates a bunch of dust. And then there's been some recent work really looking into planet occurrence rates in the systems that have these debris disks versus those that don't. And the systems that have debris disks seem like they're more likely to have large planets, which implies that the coexistence of a disk of small bodies to drive this planetesimal-driven migration should be quite common. So this should be a very common thing that happens when you have planets forming. So it's how we get this picture in our solar system, and maybe in a lot of other solar systems, where you have some sort of giant planet system that forms, you have an external debris disk, and when those things interact, the planets can move around and spread out and disperse that debris disk over time. And in this process in our own solar system, that's how you create the Kuiper Belt, and you eject a ton of material also out into the Oort cloud. So the Kuiper Belt's typically, you know, out to a few hundred AU from the sun, and then the Oort cloud's out at 10,000 AU. So you're creating these two vast small body populations and ejecting a ton of material out to interstellar space. So what are some of the most interesting open questions about this process? We're quite sure it happened, but there's a lot of details still to be hammered out, including when did it happen, how long did it happen, could we have ejected entire planets during this process, and just how much mass did we throw around throughout our planetary system when this happened? So first, when did this happen? So we think that the gas giant planets, obviously, because they accreted a bunch of gas, had to form when the sun still had its gas-rich protoplanetary disk. So we think they formed pretty early, earlier than the terrestrial planets did. So when did they actually disperse and do this migration process, though? If it happened this early, maybe it happened when the sun was still in its stellar birth cluster. And that has important implication for the transfer of material between planetary systems. If you create this Oort cloud while the sun is still in its birth cluster with a bunch of other stars around, you can actually transfer comets. So in this simulation from Levison et al., the blue dots are comets that were orbiting kind of random stars in this cluster, but at the end when the cluster disperses, they get transferred to the red star, even though that's not the star they started with. So you can transfer comets between planetary systems if migration happens early enough. Caveat here is it can be hard to eject small bodies when there's still a gas disk around your sun because the damping effects of the gas make it hard to eject stuff. But you could probably eject larger things into the Oort cloud and have them transferred in the first few million years. Another important question is, did this process happen before, during, after, maybe all of the above relative to terrestrial planet formation? This is obviously an important question for life as it arose on the Earth and how much material is being delivered to either the terrestrial planet formation region or the already formed terrestrial planets. We do have some constraints for our solar system on when this happened. First, we can actually observe the size distribution of Kuiper Belt objects on the small end range now because we had the New Horizons mission that mapped craters on Pluto and its moon Charon. And there's some evidence from that mapping that there's relatively few really small Kuiper Belt objects, which places a limit on how much this small body population could have collided back in its much more massive proto-Kuiper Belt phase before you have to disperse it. So we see that there's not maybe as many collisional fragments as you'd expect if it had gone to complete collisional equilibrium. Now, we do see a lot of evidence for collisions in the Kuiper Belt. That also implies there had to be large collisions between dwarf planets out there. All the dwarf planets that we can see have moons. Those that we've searched with Hubble all appear to have satellites that were probably collisionally generated. We see one collisional family in the Kuiper Belt. There's even rings around some of the objects. So this is obviously a collisionally rich environment, but there wasn't a huge amount of collisional grinding to create really small bodies. There's also some evidence from the existence of kind of fragile, wide binary pairs in this population, both in the classical Kuiper Belt and also in the Jupiter-Trojan population. There is a neat paper recently by David Nazvorny that shows that there's this wide binary in the Jupiter-Trojan population. There's some histories of the outer solar system where that population originates in the proto-Kuiper Belt, and if you wait too long for the proto-Kuiper Belt to get dispersed throughout the rest of the system, you would destroy this binary. So that puts some constraints on when this happened. So we think roughly it probably happened within the first 100 million years of the solar system's history. So, but that's an interesting time scale because that's kind of the same time scale as terrestrial planet formation and the Earth moon forming impact. And we don't really have tighter constraints than that. But this is really important because when the planets migrate, of course, they're going to send a lot of debris into the terrestrial planet region. We have the primordial asteroid belt that's between Mars and Jupiter that is going to be disturbed during the planet migration process. If you just lay down asteroids in a primordial asteroid belt and let the current planetary configuration sculpt them, you don't get the distribution of asteroids that we see today. Instead, if you actually have Jupiter migrate, have its mean motion resonances migrate through the asteroid belt, you get a better match to the observed asteroid distribution. And of course, where do those asteroids that you're removing from the asteroid belt go? A lot of them go into the terrestrial planet region. There's a lot of bombardment implications for that. And of course, when Neptune is outwardly migrating into the proto-Kuiper belt, it's also going to send a lot of debris into the inner solar system. So some things are going to scatter inward, some are going to scatter outward, but they're going to get delivered to the inner regions. This might be how we populate some of the Jupiter Trojans. There's going to be some contamination into the asteroid belt. And of course, this is of interest because the outer solar system bodies are icy. So this is one potential source of the delivery of volatiles and water to the inner solar system. So exactly when this happened is important. So we can deliver those things. It can also strip away things. If the Earth is already formed and has an atmosphere, there's been work looking at atmospheric stripping during impacts. So this is all very important to the evolution of the Earth and the distribution of material within our solar system. We could have perhaps even ejected entire other planets. There's lines of evidence suggesting that we had another Neptune or Uranus that we ejected during planetary migration. So this is just one simulation showing we had a five giant planet system. It actually solves some problems if you have five and eject an ice giant. It helps explain Jupiter's orbit. It can help preserve the terrestrial planets if they've already formed when planet migration happens. And of course, we see from microlensing surveys that there are free-floating planets out there, so maybe this is a pretty common process. And then the last thing here is, how much mass are we actually talking about being thrown around the solar system? Exactly how much mass there is there depends. That'll affect how far Neptune migrates, how smoothly it migrates, whether its mass mostly in Pluto-sized objects or smaller objects will affect the process, and of course affect what's hitting the terrestrial planets. We have a kind of 10 to 30 Earth mass picture, which is a lot of mass in the outer solar system that's getting thrown around. And actually, the observation of the first interstellar comet, Oumuamua, is consistent with this estimate of kind of 10 to 30 Earth masses. The fact that we see one Oumuamua means that probably this is a typical amount of mass to be ejected from a solar system during the process of planetary migration and rearrangement. So, of course, I have just raised way more questions than I have answers for. We're working on that using both theoretical and observational techniques. But I think this is a really important process that will affect both the evolution of life in our system and in other systems, and the potential to spread it throughout the galaxy, the solar system, et cetera. So thank you very much.
Thank you. That's wonderful. So some phenomena in our solar system still seem to be dynamic. The Cassini mission has implications that tell us Saturn's rings, for example, may be only 150 million years old. So I guess my question is to what extent do we feel that migration or dynamics are still happening?
Oh, it's certainly, there's certainly still dynamical events happening in our solar system. We see collisions in the asteroid belt. The fact that Saturn's rings might be young and maybe some of Saturn's moons are young is fascinating. So yeah, these kind of analog processes could still be happening. You know, the actual... there's not enough mass in the small bodies in the solar system to cause large-scale migration. You know, the current estimates for all of the small bodies in the solar system is quite small compared to the Earth masses, multiple Earth masses you need to move the planets around. So our planets are done moving on a large scale, but you know, this process could have gone on for, you know, there could have been a long tail in the early solar system, well past the point, perhaps, when we think life could have started to arise. But right now, there's no more prospects for large planet-scale migration, at least in the outer solar system.
Yeah, okay, so we're, as you know, we're worried about dating, and the most robust chronometers in our solar system looks like they haven't been seriously reset since about 4.45 billion, something like this. And of course, we're putting the date of the origin of life on Earth at about 4.36 billion years. So the question is whether you can constrain your date so that you can say not when it happened, but when it was almost certainly likely to have been over.
We don't have evidence for that yet from the dynamics. I think these important geochemical dates are going to be a clue, because when this happened, it certainly would have caused material to be impacting the terrestrial planets. So the geochronometers are going to be a very important constraint. Just from the orbit dynamics perspective, which is my area of expertise, we're kind of at the, we can constrain it to the first 100-ish million years. But we need to look at this from a multidisciplinary approach in order to come at a more precise timing of the event.
Back here. Great talk, thank you so much. I'm curious what we can learn from these ALMA images. Now, you showed kind of side by side the animation about planet formation, and then you segued to the ALMA image of HL Tau. My understanding is that the scales are different. I mean, these gaps, these beautiful gaps that we see in HL Tau, for example, are kind of out at, what, like 20 AU or something. Are they really carved out by planets, do you think? And if so, how do you explain how wide they are? And then finally, what can we learn from them with regards to these dynamical processes?
Yeah, so that's a really good question. A lot of these debris disk studies and the ALMA disks are looking at different scales than what we have seen in the solar system, and part of that is just what we can actually see so far. I haven't actually looked at the most recent HL Tau papers, but I know there have been a series of ALMA papers looking at the possibility that these gaps in other debris disks really are carved by planets. And we're actually getting to the point now where you can look at the structure of the gaps and see whether they actually are consistent with planet carved. So I think some of them are most likely carved by planets. Perhaps that's not all of them. But yeah, that's going to play a huge role as we evolve our understanding of that in figuring out, you know, when do planets form, how much debris there should be. So I think that's a really important question, and that should definitely guide our thinking for the early solar system as we figure that out.
We have time for one more. Kay. Thanks for the presentation. Do you have a sense whether on balance migration is an event favorable or not for life in the universe?
Oh, well, I'm not the best person to answer that, but I can say migration definitely could help deliver some of the materials, perhaps, for life. If we think about the early solar nebula and where there are going to be a lot of volatiles, that's going to be your outer solar system. So migration is a really good way to mix up all of those building blocks, but it also comes with the caveat that there should also be a lot of impacts that happen. So I would say it's probably not great for life that's already arisen, but that also depends on how much mass you're throwing around. But maybe it will help deliver the building blocks. But it's a little bit above my pay grade as a dynamicist. All right, thank you.